Sam Fender returns with his brilliant new album, 17 Going Under. Includes the single 17 Going Under, Get You Down, and Spit of You. Sam Fender, 17 Going Under, out now.
Hi, this is Jenna.
And this is Kelly.
And you're listening to ODFM.
This episode is One Daughter from Murder. It's good that it's not a child's death or anything, of course.
Yeah, because that's...
We can't handle that shit. We can't handle that.
We suck.
We suck at child death.
So many stories. Because I can't be serious.
Right. And if it's a child's, then we'd just be too sad. And then this episode would suck. We can't do it.
Right, exactly. So
it has to do with a daughter. So Mary Frances, otherwise known as Fanny Creighton. I don't know why she's
Fanny?
Not Franny. Yeah, Fanny.
On purpose?
Yeah, and it's weird because I kept seeing her name either as Franny or Fran or Fanny. But the most of it I saw was Fanny. So I'm going to go with Fanny.
Okay, we'll go with Fanny. Right, but we'll like, I just Fanny feel like Creighton. That's a very unfortunate nickname.
They call me Booty. Hey, Tush. How you doing? Instead of Trish. Hey, Tush.
Tush. Exactly.
Yeah. But anyway, Fanny was an alluring 24-year-old in 1923.
Really? She's not even a grandma? I mean,
No.
She was owning this shit early.
Yeah.
Okay. 23.
Yep. All right. Yep. She's like, no, I'm all about the Fanny.
She's putting it all out there.
She's okay. Shit. Whatever brings boys to the yard.
Mm-hmm.
And so she was an alluring 24-year-old in 1923.
Okay.
She had dark, curly hair, soft, pale skin, glimmering eyes, and plump lips.
Oh, my.
Sounds Hollywood.
Very.
So she had no lack of attention as a young woman from men. She had married her longtime friend, John Creighton, in 1919. He was the son of a railroad executive, while Fanny was an orphan, along with her brother and two sisters. But they were fortunate to have been raised by their well-to-do grandparents. So
that was nice. Okay.
Yeah. Luckily, and I wish I could have found out what had killed their parents, but I did not. So John, her husband, his parents owned a big two-story home in Newark, New Jersey. And after getting married, the couple moved in with his parents.
Always fun. That sounds like a great plan.
Did you ever have to do that?
God, no, thank God.
Thank God. I know. I've known so many people that do, and I'm like, oh, man, I think I'd put off getting married.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Just like, babe, we got to wait until we got some money.
Yeah.
I'm not pulling that.
That is rough.
But John worked as a clerk, and after having a baby girl, Fanny spent her time caring for their daughter in the home that they shared with her in-laws.
All right. Well, once you have live-in babysitters, that's
might change things a little, right?
That's a little better because, there's like... You know, then you're not outnumbered by the little ones, but still.
Yeah, the tiny terrors.
Oh, but then you have the in-laws constantly giving you advice. You know, what you really should be doing is warming that before you give it to them.
Oh,
then you gotta deal with that crap.
Yeah, no.
Oi.
Oi. Yeah, that's rough. But this is great. Neighbors thought Fanny was not very kind and unsociable when they came to call, which I can totally relate to. Although I'm kind, I'm just not social, but I'm good at hiding it.
Yeah, but like people with newborns don't want to entertain people.
True.
Like just trying to get a shower in people.
Yeah.
Like,
just... You know what? I am just surviving here. Leave me alone.
I have slept for a combined 45 minutes of sleep for the last 2 days, and I still have baby puke in my hair. And so sorry if I'm not feeling like having company over.
Right. Exactly. So stop coming to call.
Right. Exactly.
But after the couple moved in, John's mother fell ill, and she died at the age of 47.
Whoa.
Of a sudden heart attack. No, a sudden attack of toe pain. I'm sorry. I don't know why I said heart, because I saw attack. No, a sudden attack of toe pain. It's spelled P-T-O-M-A-I-N-E. So I had to look it up because I was like, yeah. ptomaine. So this is the early 1920s. No, I looked it up and it's basically food poisoning. What we call it, food poisoning. No.
Oh, that's weird. That they had a...
I know this medical term.
She died from food poisoning. What the hell was in her food?
Well, yum.
Yikes. Ew.
So then the family was hit with another blow when John's father, also 47, died the following year of a heart condition.
Holy crap.
I know. So like everybody's kicking the bucket. 47. That's the birthday I just had.
Oh, crap. Oh my God. Watch your food, man.
Like, yeah, no shit.
Keep an eye on weight.
Don't get ptomaine or whatever that is. It sounds like chow mein, but worse.
Maybe she had some bad Chinese.
Maybe that was it. I mean, you can't trust everything you
some
find.
Some bad ptomaine.
Ptomaine. It does. It sounds like a total. Oh, Fanny's brother and sisters lived nearby, still with their grandparents that had raised them. And Fanny and her sisters were not getting along and arguing over their inheritance from their deceased parents. That's fun.
Okay.
So in early 1923, Fanny's brother Charles came to spend a weekend with them, her and her husband, and she convinced him to stay for a while. So she must have actually liked this brother.
She must have liked him. I'm just wondering if they lived nearby, why did he have to stay?
Like, I know, right? She's like, you need out of that house with those evil sisters. She even helped Charles find a job as a clerk in a store in the neighborhood. So that's nice. So he's like, sure, I'll come, Albert.
Okay.
Stay with you. However, in early April of the same year, her brother got sick. And he was sick enough that he went to a doctor. So it must have meant that he was feeling pretty shitty because most men don't actually go for help.
Right. He must have been feeling really bad. Also, how close in age was he to being 47?
Right.
Just curious. Was he
I'm guessing he was in his 20s, like what's her face, Fanny. But he told the doctor, although, you know, when I think of men getting sick, they are like so dramatic.
Right.
The man flu.
Did he have the ptomaine or did he just have like man flu or?
Maybe it's a combination. Yeah. So he told the doctor he's dealing with a continuous stomach ache and an insatiable thirst that made his tongue feel furry. And I was thinking.
He had a furry tongue. Stop licking yourself, man.
Stop licking the dog.
That will hairballs like the cat?
Like a cat. That will give you a stomach ache and a furry tongue. Stop it.
I just literally, it came up in like Facebook suggestions of like things you might want to buy. It was like a combination of like a rubber brush that you could use on the cat, but it had a flap so you could put it in your mouth and then
what?
Like
lick. Oh, pretend to lick them?
You. Yes, and it was a real God. Product. Mm-mm. Like people pay money. I'm like,
this is twisted.
This was. I was like, is this like from The Onion or is this like an SNL thing? No. It was real.
Oh no!
Buy it
when you really want to bond with your cat.
I was just like, I mean, even if I was the cat, I'd be like, what the fuck? Like,
yeah, don't touch me. You're getting a little
thing
too
away
close.
From me. This is.
Oh no,
honey, you need a boyfriend.
But you're not getting one now. Oh, no.
Okay. Anyway, sorry. That's what it made me think of when I thought of his furry tongue.
Well, the doctor didn't think he needed the cat licking tongue. He thought he must have an infection. So he prescribed a tonic. You know, back in the days, they had tonics.
This all sounds so fake.
I know. It sounds like some old TV show based on the 20s that wasn't real. But it is.
Did you see the movie The Birdcage
with Robin loved Williams the and stuff? Birdcage,
and they were
yes.
trying to calm him down by giving him the purine tablets.
Yes. Just, I need that's a purine like, tablet.
Right, I mean, what is this medicine he's taking? It's just aspirin I scraped off the A and the S.
So good.
Such a
good movie.
Sorry. That's what all of this sounds like. I'm going to just give you a purine tablet. You'll be fine.
A little tonic. You're good. Yeah, I'm guessing the tonic's probably like whiskey or something.
Right.
A week later, on April 12th, Charles returned to the doctor because his symptoms had gotten even worse. Yikes. He was now always nauseous and had a burning sore throat.
Stop. Oh, God.
Yeah. So the doctor increased the dosage of medicine, but it didn't seem to make a difference, and he just kept getting sicker. And on April 20th, Charles started having a seizure.
Oh, my God.
Fanny calls a neighbor to come help, saying that Charles is making some strange noise, but yeah. I would say.
And the door is locked. Don't go in.
Don't go in there. He's just making funny noises. I don't want to know.
Just go downstairs. Just wait a while. I mean, just
it'll stop. Yeah. Turn up the radio. And so the neighbor, though, felt that they didn't felt like they knew the house well enough. And she didn't like Fanny enough to come help. Quite the neighbor. I know. I was like, what an asshole.
My neighbor comes and knocks on the door and there's like, you know, oh my God, like someone is in trouble in my house. I'm like, I'm not really familiar with the layout of your home. And I don't know you well.
And I just don't really like you.
You know, I just, no.
Sorry, no. So yes, so that neighbor didn't come help. So, but I think somebody called the doctor. I don't know if the neighbor did or Fanny.
So random.
But when the doctor got there, he was shocked when he found Charles vomiting uncontrollably, his limbs stiffening and shaking, apparently.
Right.
And very close to death, and indeed died very quickly upon seeing him. So, like, doctor gets there, sees all this, and basically Charles just, like, kicks a bucket.
Shit. Yikes.
Not good. And the doctor couldn't understand how the boy had gotten so sick, and he called another doctor to consult him about the kicks, because he's like, yeah, I've seen this guy twice. He was
not even
close.
It's a little late for a second opinion now. I mean, I feel like that should have happened maybe at the second visit. Like,
he should have maybe asked beforehand. But he needed a second opinion on what to put on the death certificate, basically.
Ah, okay, okay.
So the two doctors decided it was a rare, violent attack of gastroenteritis. Something along the lines of what John's mother had suffered. So basically, like, food poisoning. You have some really bad stuff going on.
It sounded like, you know, he died of like bad gas. I was like, he exploded from the inside out. Like he just
really bad gas.
I didn't realize that the invention of gas X like saved lives. I
you know, take it before you have any tomaine.
Oh my God.
I hope that's not a real thing. All the Chinese restaurants be like, you asshole.
Right. Sorry, we didn't know.
I didn't know it was real. It could have probably been left at that. Like, nothing would have been investigated except for the arrival of a very suggestive letter to the detectives. So soon after the mother-in-law, after she died, an anonymous source, some believe it was a bread delivery man who was sick of being stiffed by the plump and crabby Fanny Creighton, had sent the police a package of yellowed newspaper clippings dating back to 1923 about the deaths of the two parents.
Okay, so little tip for those of you out there, if you're going to commit a crime, make sure you're tipping all of your delivery drivers because they may have some dirt on you.
They probably
do. And they're going to be the ones that rat you out because you stiffed them.
Exactly. Just tip everybody. Tip everyone.
Just to be safe. Just tip
everybody. Especially in America. Yeah.
Heavily. Just tip heavily.
So he wrote on the letter, "Is death not ground for suspicion? This boy feared his sister as he feared death. I am very sorry that I cannot sign my name. I am just an outsider who was very fond of this boy. Please act quickly and beware. You will find it hard to trap this liar."
Wow. Okay.
Sounds like he knew a lot more than he's letting on. But
he's very fond of this boy. Okay.
So, maybe he worked with him at the grocery store or whatever, the corner store. Who knows?
That's weird. But I don't know. If he was so afraid of his sister, why was he staying there?
Right.
Interesting.
Yeah, so the detectives went and interviewed the attending physician who had seen Charles, and they found that the doctor had also been contemplating his own diagnoses, the one that he had written on the death certificate. He admitted that it was surprising that John's parents had died so suddenly, so he had known the parents as well. The police came upon another surprising discovery. Fanny had convinced her brother to invest in a life insurance policy, naming her as the beneficiary.
I swear, life insurance does more damage than good, I feel like. Oh my God, this is, yeah.
So it was for $1,000, but the equivalent today would be $16,000. So still not a huge amount, but it was desperate times.
Okay.
So at the small store Fanny's brother Charles had worked at, the owner mentioned that Charles had complained about the incessant amount of chocolate pudding he was given by his sister. Stop giving me pudding.
I do happen to like any dessert that's called death by chocolate.
Yes.
But this is a totally different. Usually I am, you know, the more like triple chocolate, death by chocolate, you know, double chocolate chip brownie.
Death.
Like, usually that's my thing, but So yeah, I would totally have gotten sucked into this really bad.
I know. Yes. Keep bringing the chocolate pudding. Just keep it coming.
Shit.
So he had told her, you know, I'm like over this. I don't want any more. But she would constantly insist that he eat a little before bed. You know, just have a bite. Just a bite or two. I keep making this. I just keep making it. And someone needs to eat it.
Damn it. It's the only dessert I know how to make. Just humor me.
Just eat it. This seemed pretty odd, obviously. So the detectives searched the house that they had all lived in together. In these times, women would use something called Fowler's solution to keep their skin pale and clear.
Okay.
So it was a popular tonic that could be found at any corner store at the time. The thing about it was to create the look of near translucent skin. Arsenic was added to it.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. So...
does that work on acne?
In fact...
because what I have right now is not working, so I'm just curious. I just...
that's funny, because yes, the arsenic... the arsenic was the key ingredient, and a low level of poisoning in the user is what gave the ladies a semi-transparent, smooth skin look.
It was the look of death.
Yes, the look of death. You look pale enough that you could be dead, but you're not.
Right, exactly.
But you are slowly killing yourself.
Oh my God. Death by face lotion. Wow.
Right. So Fowler's solution was found amongst Fanny's possessions, but it wasn't that weird because a lot of women had it. I mean, it was pretty much every woman had it. So upon finding the skin tonic in the house, police had Charles' body exhumed. The resulting autopsy and chemical tests found arsenic present in every organ.
Yikes.
So Fanny and her husband were arrested on suspicion of murder of Charles. Okay. And they planned to dig up John's parents as well to test their remains.
Oh.
They were like, huh, that's weird. They all had the same symptoms.
Was she poisoning them, or was she just trying to make them look nice?
Maybe she was just doing their makeup.
Right? Maybe she was just like,
eat
the girls
pudding.
Are never going to like you like that. Like, let me
eat some pudding while I do your skin. Yes.
Exactly.
So John and Fanny subsequently hired a well-known defense attorney and former prosecutor named James McCarthy. Okay. He claimed there was no way his clients were guilty of such crimes. The couple claimed they were shocked to learn that so much arsenic was floating around in Charles' body. And they didn't disagree that it was in his system, but they denied any involvement of getting it into his body.
Okay.
This is good. The attorney went so far as to claim that Charles may have even taken the arsenic himself after Fanny told Charles of having been through a breakup just prior to his death. Because everybody for a suicide would want to go through horrible pain and, slow death.
That's the way you want to do it.
That's the way everybody commits suicide, right? So during the trial, the attorney claimed the discovery of Fowler's solution meant little, as it could be found in most households at the time. And besides, it's a very diluted poison. And it would end up taking gallons of the solution to bring about the amount the scientists have found.
Oh, jeez. Okay. So, yeah. All right.
And the amount they had found was 4 times the lethal dose. Just wasn't possible that could have been the way. Okay. And nobody had seen or had any record of Fanny or John going and buying large amounts of the tonic or other arsenic. So, yeah.
How much acne do you have?
So much. Like, it's body, man. I'm going to bathe in this shit.
Right.
In fact, the store Charles worked at had products like one called Rough on Rats. Rough on Rats.
Okay.
So he had plenty of access to loads of arsenic himself. Apparently, there was such a thing at the time as arsenic eaters. So have you ever watched that show of people that eat weird shit? What's it called?
Oh, God. Like My Strange Obsession or something like that.
Addiction.
There was a woman.
My Strange.
Yes. She was like, it was the one woman who was like eating the foam out of couch cushions.
Yes. And one that was eating deodorant. I'm like, what? And clay. Woo. What is wrong with you? Clay seems the least worse out of them all.
Oh my God. Still. Yeah.
Yeah. So this time they had arsenic eaters. And
on purpose?
Yeah. They would even spread arsenic on toast, believing that it had health benefits.
Like jam?
Like jam. They thought it was, you know, it was the anti-vaxxers of their time.
Is there a version of the ivermectin or whatever?
Yes, exactly. Yes. So... they would spread it on toast, believing it had health benefits and gave some level of immunity against poisoning because there was so much poisoning going around.
It was the OG avocado toast, but it was arsenic toast.
It was arsenic toast. Can I have some arsenic toast, please?
Right.
Ooh, so they thought, well, it's possible. Maybe Charles was one of these believers, you know?
Okay.
The lawyer pointed out that the anonymous letter could have been sent by a vengeful neighbor or someone who just didn't like the Creightons. So as for the $1,000 from their life insurance, after funeral expenses, not much more than a few hundred was left. But I would still think in that day, that's quite a bit.
Okay. It's an interesting way to buy your own house, move in with the owners, and then get rid of them.
Hey, it worked. So on June 23rd, both Fanny and John were acquitted of all charges. Okay. Fanny, ever the delicate flower, fainted in her lawyer's arms at the news.
Oh my God.
I know, so dramatic. But there was still the question of what had happened to John's parents, Walter and Annie Creighton.
Also, how did her brother Charles actually eat all of that arsenic? Where did it come from? Okay.
All right. There's a lot of questions still. So they were exhumed, which ignited a journalistic firestorm.
Oh boy.
Police had to patrol the grounds constantly as photographers were climbing the cemetery walls, trying to get the most drama-worthy shots.
Oh my God.
Not surprised. I mean,
the Kardashians of the 1920s.
I know. So in fact, one photographer was able to almost make it to the grave site where he was arrested and charged with disorderly conduct.
Oh my gosh.
Dude, back off. So pathologists, for some reason, decided to forego moving the bodies to the morgue and instead made a makeshift autopsy room directly above the gravesite.
That doesn't seem like a very scientific
way to do that. Right. So they set up a rough tent and performed the autopsies on gurneys at the site.
Okay.
They weren't able to determine exactly what killed the couple, but they were able to say that the two did not die of the diseases that had been listed on their death certificates.
Ooh.
Like stomach. Oops. Yeah. Like the
food poisoning and heart failure
is what they thought his was.
Hmm.
Walter, John's dad, seemed to be clear of poison. They couldn't find much for traces of it, but his mother had the telltale white crystals showing the presence of arsenic. So they knew she had arsenic.
Okay.
So just one day after being acquitted of Charles' murder, Fanny was once again arrested and charged with murdering her mother-in-law. Damn.
24 hours. 24 hours of freedom.
So a nurse who had cared for John's mother testified that she had become sick after Fanny fixed her a cup of cocoa. She likes fixing things with chocolate.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. It must mask the taste. I don't know. Annie had been just recovering when Fanny asked to watch over her while the nurse went down to eat breakfast. And when the nurse returned 20 minutes later, Annie's eyes were fixed and they were wide and fearful looking.
Oh, geez. That was one hell of a cup of cocoa.
Yeah, it's a good cup of cocoa. So the nurse immediately reacted, asking what happened, hurrying to try to help her patient. But Annie just looked at her, helpless. Oh, and gurgling.
Oh, Jesus.
And then promptly vomited on the floor. The nurse quickly summoned the doctor, telling him he was urgently needed. And she and the doctor fought for an hour to save her. But Annie died later that morning in December of 1920. The doctor had initially thought Annie had suffered a stroke since she wasn't even able to speak. He thought it come on suddenly because of some sort of food poisoning. So that's why he put that on her death certificate. Only after the previous trial and new coverage did he realize that Annie's symptoms had been consistent with arsenic poisoning. So John claimed there was no way Fanny had killed his mother, and he sat behind Fanny during the subsequent trial, displaying his support for her. He's like, there's no way she would do this, my sweet Fanny.
Oh, dear God.
But prosecutors came to trial armed with some powerful circumstantial evidence, like the mysterious deaths of several members of the family, as well as a couple of the family's dogs in the previous few years.
What? What the hell did they do to her?
What did the dogs do? Evil woman. Prosecutors presented the testimony of two prominent and respected pathologists who both believed that Annie had been killed with arsenic, while Fanny's lawyer had three of their own experts who methodically tore apart the prosecution's case. The original doctor, who had diagnosed the cause of Annie's death, thought that her food poisoning diagnosis probably still fit the best. And another expert agreed, saying that had arsenic been the cause of death, more extensive damage would have been evident. It would have taken its toll on her organs a lot more. And then they had another expert, a third expert. He agreed that the amount of arsenic found was infinitesimal. So
these guys don't know what they're talking about. Oh my God, you guys don't know enough.
At the beginning of the science of all this. So arsenic compounds in the liver, but Annie's didn't have that much. So they were like, I don't think that's what killed her. In fact, arsenic in murder cases has always mystified criminologists for several reasons. It has many problems associated with its use as means of death. The biggest problem is that arsenic is easily detected at post-mortem examinations, even in minute quantities.
Okay.
And the human body maintains a natural level of arsenic.
Oh.
So we naturally kind of have some of it in us. And so this fact was utilized as a trial defense because it's in everybody. So of course we could say,
yeah,
they must have just had it there. And it's a simple procedure to measure the levels to refute the claim. So if it's too low of a level, it's like, it was probably natural there. It's tough in poisoning to measure exactly how much of the drug to use for arsenic since people have a different tolerance to it.
Okay.
Which forces someone who's trying to kill someone with it to use a large amount, which virtually assures it'll be detected at autopsy since a large amount can easily be found. They'd be like, that's obvious that that's what happened. But
so you have to give them just a little bit at a time?
Yep. But since a large amount at one time can be tasted by the victim, that's why people often resort to chronic poisoning using many small doses over a period of time. But then that also like raises their tolerance. So then they have to keep adding more. Based on all the testimonies of the experts and the fact that no one had seen Fanny adding spoonfuls of arsenic to their food,
right. The
jury found Fanny not guilty of murder a third time.
Oh, jeez.
For all three. So as of July 13th, she was a free woman.
Again,
yes. And she told reporters that, quote, I bear no malice toward anyone. I realize the prosecutor did his duty. I have no plans for the future, and I don't know what I shall do. I am too happy with my family just now to think of anything else, but I shall never forget this Friday the 13th. Because that was the day she was... she was let out.
Mm.
And maybe you'll reconsider using that arsenic powder.
Yeah, you know, but it does so well for my...
You have such porcelain skin.
I know.
Translucent. I can see all your veins.
Yeah, it's funny when you say translucent. I'm just like, yeah, so you want to see the bones and the veins and the muscles?
Yeah.
Because that's hot. That's a good look.
Good look. Ugh, I can see your blood pumping.
Gross.
Are you ready?
Yes, I'm ready.
All right. So Fanny and John Creighton lived a quiet life since their acquittals for some 12 years.
Okay. They took a breather.
Like, I guess we shouldn't kill any more dogs or people for a while. So they sold their house in New Jersey and the house that they got.
Right, exactly.
And bought a small place in the Long Island town of Baldwin.
Okay.
Don't know if that's where all the Baldwins come from, but it would make sense because there's so many of them. They just breed the Baldwins. So John worked in the county engineer's office and they had their daughter, Ruth, that had been born before. She was 15. And their son, who had been born after, was named Jack, and he was 12. They attended the local schools, and John was active in the American Legion, and he made a friend there named Everett Applegate. Everett was an officer at the American Legion and worked as an investigator in the Veterans Relief Bureau. Don't know what that means.
Nope. No clue.
Nope. He and his family, which included his wife and daughter, lived with his wife Ada's parents.
Okay.
Everett wasn't getting along with his in-laws, and the Creightons are like, it seems to be a theme. The Creightons, both Fanny and John, were like, hey, we know it's tough living there. Why don't you come stay with us and live with us in our house? And there we can split all the costs because this is the Great Depression now.
Oh, yikes. Okay.
There were only two bedrooms on the ground floor, which the adults stayed in, and the daughters stayed in the attic, and the boy, the only boy in the family, Jack, slept on a cot on the porch.
On the porch? He didn't even get to come inside?
No, he's 12.
He is going to need so much therapy. So tell me, why do you think your parents didn't love you? Well, they made me sleep outside.
On a cot.
Okay.
So the house was crowded, obviously, but at the time, the country was in the throes of the Great Depression, so it was actually quite normal to have multiple families living in one home. Ada, Everett's wife, wasn't very well liked by the neighborhood. not unlike Fanny.
Again, wow, people just are like rude and mean and just do not like people. Wow.
Yeah, so she was difficult to get along with in general. She got annoyed by people easily, and she took to criticizing them. She didn't just, you know, shut up.
All right,
she was like, "You're a piece of shit." And she would.
Yeah, that'll make people not like you.
It will. Yeah, you know what? You look like shit in that dress.
Well, right.
Okay. Thanks.
Yeah, doesn't have a lot of friends. Not surprising.
However, maybe because she's a lot like Fanny, I don't know. Fanny and John seemed to get along just fine with her, and the families coexisted easily. They're just assholes.
You're our kind of asshole. We like you.
Hang out. We'll just be all assholes together. So in September of 1936, Ada, who was 36 at the time, became really sick.
Oh, God.
I know. Weird. So she's throwing up violently and was having such severe abdominal pain that she couldn't even stand upright. You know, like when you're like bent over. Like, ugh. So her doctor suspected a gallbladder problem. So he sends her to the hospital. And after a week's stay there, she was released to go home. She was still a little shaky and feeling not so great. So she went straight to bed. And she wasn't feeling well enough to eat yet and could only keep down a little milk, sometimes with a little egg and sugar mixed into it.
Milk with egg and sugar mixed in?
Yeah. Otherwise known as eggnog.
Oh, okay.
Isn't that crazy? I know it sounds much better saying just eggnog. That's what I was saying too. And I kept reading that, and then I'd read eggnog somewhere else and I was like, oh, that makes sense.
Okay.
That is what eggnog is, except usually has some little rum or something. But yeah.
Right.
Oh, speaking of, my mom used to love this. Oh, so gross when we were little. She would use hard boiled eggs and smash it up. Add milk and salt and pepper and eat it.
Mm.
Like, I know. See, doesn't it? It does that to me too. And I would be like, oh, mom.
What the hell?
I don't know.
Whew. That sounds terrible.
Doesn't it? I don't know. Milk and eggs together for some reason.
Yeah, it's really, that's throwing me.
So just 2 days later, though, after having gotten home, she woke up again in a state of extreme illness that came on with such ferocity that she kept passing out.
Like, oh my God.
It was so bad. So her husband, Everett's beside himself. He calls the doctor and the police, begging for oxygen to be brought to her because she's having trouble breathing.
Oh my God.
When the doctor showed up, police were there trying to get Ada to breathe, but she had already died. I know.
Oh God.
Ada was not a dainty gal, especially for what was normal in that day.
Not dainty.
Not
a very
a dainty
nice
gal.
Way to put that.
So in that day and age, I mean, people were a lot smaller then, you know.
Mm-hmm.
She had been obese for quite a while, and she weighed almost 270 pounds, which doesn't sound that unusual these days, but back then it was.
Okay.
So her doctor had been trying to help her with weight loss for a while now, so he was like, her heart, it must have just been too overtaxed, and gave out.
Okay. That was the reasoning. Okay.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So on her death certificate, he wrote that she had died from coronary occlusion, and her body was sent to the funeral home. But police, they weren't so quick to accept the doctor's diagnosis because they happened to know of the Creighton's history and that they'd been accused of murder before.
Ooh, and someone else who is living with them has died again.
So they asked Ada's husband if they could order an autopsy on his dead wife. This is Everett. So, but shockingly, he's like, nope. He refused.
Hmm.
So the district attorney's like, I'll give him a call. So he calls Everett and he's like, you know, we could force an autopsy, but it would look better for you if you agreed to it and consented.
Hmm.
So reluctantly, he's like, fine, I guess. So pathologist sent samples to a lab to be tested where the scientists discovered arsenic again in every organ.
You guys,
in her
just
body.
Change it up then. I mean,
God. Maybe use some olean or whatever the other.
Good God.
Something else. Yeah, I don't know. The well-known scientist, Alexander Gettler, said that Ada had been given 3 times the lethal dose of arsenic.
Oh my God.
So on October 6th, Fanny Creighton was charged with murder along with Ada's husband, Everett. So, what?
Oh my God.
Coming back. So this time it's not her husband that's being charged. It's Ada's husband.
Oh.
Because he had originally wanted to refuse.
Oh God. Okay.
The
so it's
so they figured,
Fanny and
Everett now. John's like, what the hell? Right. How did I get put out of this one? Man, I was in. Why'd I get left out? So the crazy thing is that Gettler, Alexander Gettler, the scientist who'd been well known in, mm-hmm. in the field of all this, had been a defense witness for Fanny's earlier murder trials.
Oh.
His own chemical analysis had helped clear her for the murder of her mother-in-law. So he believed she just somehow outwitted detection and that the levels didn't show and all this. But he thought that, of course, the poison wasn't from Fowler's solution, which okay. the police had found, but the pesticide called Rough on Rats that Fanny had probably thrown out the can for, so it hadn't been found at the scene. So that
that's the it. Police that's, are they like, just, eh, they didn't you're good. Find it, so they just assume.
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah. So when he ran the I didn't find it at her house. She must not have done it.
Right.
So, yeah. That arsenic-filled formula was also the poison that was found in Ada's body, right down to the other ingredients mixed into the rat killer.
Oh.
Those exact same ingredients, which I think I had read it was like soil or something. Something weird, you know. Maybe rats like eating soil.
Okay.
But those things had been in every person's body that they had tested. They just didn't recognize that that was from that specific brand until later. Though she was once a beauty, Fanny's good looks had faded. And now...
because they wouldn't let her have her tonic. Well, her that was solution. It.
The Fowler's was out of stock. So she now appeared much older than her age of 36, probably because she'd been using Fowler's solution all over her skin for years.
Right, exactly, right?
Kept poisoning herself.
You think smoking ages you because you use arsenic on your
wait
face.
Until you use arsenic. I mean... try that for a while. She was stout and had a triple chin and looked a little like a frog.
What?
Photos. So, Kermit, I can relate. Everett was the same age as Fanny, but he looked way younger. He hadn't been using the Fanny. The
no,
Fowler's
the Fanny. He hadn't been using her Fanny.
As a powder puff. Yeah. What?
Dude,
no,
what?
Stop using the Fanny. He was slim with brown hair and blue eyes, and he was proud of his good looks. So detectives thought, maybe these guys are having an affair. A love affair. Mm. But when they asked Everett about that possibility, he's like, I am for sure not in an love affair with that woman.
He's oh, like, hell no.
Oh, have you God. Seen her? No.
Ugh.
But police were actually close with their theory, and it wasn't Fanny that Everett was involved with.
Wait, what?
You know how there's other girls in the house? Yeah. He had his eye on Fanny's beautiful 15-year-old daughter, Ruth.
Oh, no.
Pedophile. This was the exchange he had with authorities about that. So I'll quote their
okay.
little
oh, Jesus. Okay.
interview they had with him. Question. You had intercourse with Ruth in the very bed where your wife lay? Everett says, yes. Question. What did your wife say to that? Everett.
Stop bumping me. Sorry.
Yeah. Stop shaking the bed. Oh.
Oh, no. She wasn't there at the time. Sorry. Okay.
Well, just wait. No. Everett said, Everett's reply, she didn't know anything about the intercourse. Question, you were nude? Everett, yes. Question, was your wife nude? Everett, yes. Question, and Ruth slept nude? Answer, she came in clothed. Question, but she soon stripped. Everett, yes. Question, so we have a picture of your wife and Ruth and you in this bed nude. I'm assuming by picture they mean worth picturing.
Okay. I was like, what the hell snapped this picture? Okay. I get you. Okay. They're imagining.
They've got one of those old ones.
So now we're talking about a threesome. Yeah. Oh, okay.
Except he's saying that she was asleep and was unaware the whole time, somehow, that his wife was.
But why is everyone, in the Great Depression, did nobody have money for pajamas? So they all just look nude? Why is everyone, what?
Because when you're a dirty pedophile, you're ready to. Ready at
How
any time.
Sound of a sleeper? What's this
Not sure if that's the real story, but we'll see.
Okay.
So the trial for Everett and Fanny began January 13 of 1936. Everett testified that he'd wanted to marry Ruth Creighton, even though he's already married.
Okay.
Ruth testified that Everett had once asked her if she would like him better if he were single. And maybe closer to my age, too. That might be helpful. And she also told them an incident in which she was riding home in Everett's car with Everett and Ada, and the couple was arguing. And when they got to the house, Ada slammed out of the car. Her husband came after her, knocking her to the ground. And she got up screaming at him, quote, "If I was Ruth, you wouldn't have done that," unquote. So it seems Ada was aware of the affair to some degree, or that he was obsessed with her at least. Huh. So,
okay. Interesting.
According to Everett, John was the only innocent parent in the Creighton family. So Fanny's husband, John, he even said, yeah, he has nothing to do with anything. So he testified that Fanny had known that Ruth was sleeping with him and that she was even helping him keep track of Ruth's menstrual periods because she liked the idea of her daughter being married and out of the crowded house.
Okay, but she can't move out of the crowded house because the guy she's sleeping with also lives in the house.
Yeah, they're hoping that he'll get her pregnant, he'll have to marry her, and they'll have to move out. But they kind of need to get rid of Ada out of the picture so that he could do that.
It's a very, very bizarre plan.
Mm-hmm. It really is. Everett's lawyer was hoping to show, by him testifying about all this, that Everett was a sex fiend, but he's not a murderer.
Always better to be a sex fiend than a murderer.
Yeah, but it didn't work well. So Everett admitted that he'd driven Fanny to a drugstore to buy a packet of Rough on Rats, and he had even paid for it. But he insisted that she had told him she needed the poison to deal with some mice in the house. He was shocked when his wife died. Fanny testified that Everett had taken her to the drugstore and had given her 25 cents to get the rat powder, and then he'd taken it from her and put it in his pocket. He was the one with the rat poison.
What? Okay.
Yeah, they're trying to basically pin it on each other.
Right.
So about the night of the murder, Fanny said, quote, "Shortly after dinner that night, I went to the icebox and got the milk and poured it into a glass. And he," meaning Everett, "gave me or handed me a powder and told me to put it in the milk, sort of a grayish white substance on a white paper."
Oh, okay.
This is another question answer thing they were doing in trial. Question, "You knew the powder was arsenic?" Answer, "Only his saying so." Question, "So when you put that eggnog on Ada's table and waited for her to drink it, you knew there was arsenic in it?" She says, "Yes, that's true." Question, "And you stood by and watched her die?" Answer, "I didn't know she was dying." Question,
"What was she doing?"
Question, "You didn't know she was dying?" She says, "Well, not exactly." Okay, so this is all on the stand.
Oh, like, boy.
You dumbass.
And it's also not the first time she's been in a trial and questioned about poisoning people.
Right.
This is terrible.
But she's gotten away with it a few times before, or a couple times before.
So I do not recall. Yeah.
So on January 30th, Mary Frances Creighton, Fanny, and Everett Applegate were convicted of first-degree murder, which at that time, first-degree murder made the sentence of death mandatory.
Oh, geez. Okay.
So they were sent to Sing Sing Prison, known as, you know, like the roughest, mm-hmm. worst prison, to await the
results.
It's
the rough on rats prison.
All you get to eat tonight is pudding and rough on rats.
Right.
So they had to go there to await their result of their appeals, because of course they were appealing everything. In her cell in Sing Sing Prison, Fanny was obviously excited at the prospect of a favorable result being reached by the Court of Appeals. She's like, yeah, I got away with it. Murder before, so it's likely she would again, she thought. But when the news came through that the original death sentence had been affirmed, she lost it. Lost her mind. She didn't eat much other than ice cream. And I was like, you get ice cream there? Even at that time?
It's the Great Depression and she can still have ice cream in prison?
Right. I was thinking, shouldn't have been with it. Yeah.
Like slop?
Gulag or something, whatever you would call it.
Right.
I don't know what gulag is. Just making shit up. Ah, shit on a shingle, as my dad would always say. Shit nice. On a shingle. So she'd just have a little bit of ice cream and she lay on her bed in her cell crying and moaning. And she rarely slept, but when she did, she would wake up screaming, "I can't stand it. I can't stand it."
Oh my God.
Yeah, well, it's your own fault. So something that made her freak out even further, which is unsurprising, is that at least 10 men were electrocuted while she's waiting for her time. And it wasn't concealed in the least. I'm not sure if, like, they would walk the inmates past them, like, in the Green Mile or whatever, or
Or just she'd watch the lights flicker every time.
Yeah, that's what I was wondering. Or they could hear it or smell it. Or,
yeah.
Maybe it was just passed around by the guards, but they knew it was happening. So, of course, her distress is even more. Before their scheduled execution times, which was planned back to back, like one after the other.
Buttons to the end.
Oh, God, for real. The warden allowed Fanny and Everett visitation with their families that same night.
Oh, okay. Beforehand.
So Everett's father and his stepmother came to visit, and Everett's father was able to have a brief meeting with his son. And he was quoted as saying, "I said goodbye, Ev." And he said, "Goodbye, Pop." And that was all. So, gee, that was heartfelt. Thanks, Dad. Good to know how much you love me.
Oh, my God.
Okay, bye, son. Cool. Good luck on that. Have a good afterlife. John Creighton had visited Fanny, his wife, and was allowed to hug and kiss her for the last time. He was never sure that Fanny had killed his own mother. So he really didn't.
Really? He still wasn't sure.
Yeah, I don't know.
Or his dad.
Or his dad.
Or her brother.
John actually broke down and cried openly while he was there. And as he left, he threatened to shoot any reporter who asked him questions. Don't even ask me fucking questions.
Okie dokie.
So in the waiting room, as reporters gathered to enter the witness room, because all the reporters got to go witness the death too, I guess. Ugh. I know, which is creepy. Agnes Applegate, who was the daughter of
Everett
and his wife. Sorry.
Okay.
Agnes, who was 13, and Ruth, the love interest of Everett, was 15. And they sat there munching on hamburgers, as reported by the New York Daily News, while awaiting.
That's so.
They're just
Do you think they also sat there and had girl talk about, so I slept with your dad again.
Oh.
Right. I mean.
Seriously. Gross. That same night, Fanny became worse and worse, and she pretty much had become bedridden by that time after all the ice cream. So she lost a lot of weight.
Hey, if you're lactose intolerant, that'll really do a number on you. I mean,
she had so much diarrhea. So much diarrhea. My asshole's on fire. So on the day of her execution, July 16th of 1936, the executioner was surprised to find Fanny in a state of utter despair, which I was like, I'm surprised you're not finding that more with people you're going to execute.
Right.
So instead of dressing like a lot of them did, they dressed nice for their execution. Weird.
They
also.
Do?
I guess. Yeah. But she wore a pink nightgown with a robe and some black slippers. And once again, I was like, I thought they had the stripe things.
Hey, what
back
the
then.
Hell?
Yeah,
the movie's
prison clothes.
Lying to us.
So much lying. And she held a rosary in her one hand, and she had to be placed in a wheelchair as she refused to walk. So just like a little kid with a tantrum.
Oh,
but
God. Okay.
I guess that would be a good reason to have a tantrum. Mm-hmm. I do not want to die, thanks. So she was limp and unconscious when she was finally wheeled into the execution room.
That's probably best.
Exactly. And she had to be lifted into the electric chair. She was strapped in without resistance. Ooh. They had shaved the back of her head. And she seemed to be completely passed out when they actually flipped the switch. She had no reaction. And so it seemed like she had died without being even aware that she was being killed, which would be probably
so she slowly
best.
Wasted away on bits of ice cream. That's not a bad way to go.
No, that would probably be better than being aware of your own execution.
Totally, right?
Oh, this is kind of gruesome, but it's worth noting. So, warning. To show the level of heat that's generated in a person being electrocuted, one of the guards on duty that night suffered severe burns after coming into contact with Fanny's body while releasing her from the chair. Normally, this is prevented because of the thick clothing the people usually wear.
But because she was wearing a nightgown?
But her thin nightgown didn't provide any protection, so he got severely burned.
They don't wait for her to,
cool off?
I mean...
Well, the next execution was scheduled directly after hers.
Well, no, but...
Maybe give it half an hour. I don't know. So immediately following Fanny's execution, with the odors of the burning electrocution still in the air, Everett was brought in for his execution.
Well, crap, when he sat down, was everything still hot?
It was probably still hot. Smells and the smoke and So he further proclaimed his innocence, which I kind of wonder if he wasn't involved with her death, but once again, proclaimed that, but he was still put to death, of course.
Yikes.
I know. I was like, oh God, what if he really didn't have anything? Because he did seem all freaked out when she was dying, and he had called the police and the doctor and was like, help her breathe, get some oxygen. Yeah. I don't know what's going on. So it kind of makes you wonder if she just really wanted him to be with her daughter. Blah. So that's why it's $1.
Gross.
For murder. So gross. Anyway, so that's that story.
They blamed it on her nightgown. I'm sorry, I'm going to need you to pick your execution outfit, and I need you to wear like a heavy flannel or a sweater.
Maybe some wool.
Right? Yeah. We need something thick.
Something a little more substantial, please.
Why? I'm going to get real toasty. I'm going to be fine.
I'm going to be hot. Yeah, maybe they should give them some special gloves.
I'm just going to wear like a tank top and like...
I'm just going to wear my cute little flip-flops. Mm-hmm. Creepy. So a lot of this came from... So there was a show I was watching called... The Poisoner's Handbook. And it's such a good show.
Oh.
It's several different episodes, but it's mostly actually about Gettler guy, okay. About how he figured out the science behind all the arsenic and poisoning and all this kind of stuff.
Okay.
And he actually came up with all the tests that are still used today to figure out all these different kinds of different
that's
poisons.
Interesting.
So it's really an interesting show to watch. And that's where I heard about Fanny and I was like, oh my God, this woman. Woman, and that he had been fooled by her, and he could not live that down for the rest of his life. He's like, I'm never going to let that happen again, to be fooled by someone poisoning. That, there was also a book about it, which is where the show came from. It's called The Poisoner's Handbook, Murder and the Birth of Forensic Medicine in the Jazz Age in New York by Deborah Bloom.
Ooh, okay.
Yeah, it's very good. Murderpedia, of course.
Of course.
The Library of Congress, which is interesting.
Oh.
Yeah. They have a lot of info. womenincrimeinc.blogspot.com.
Okay.
Oh, we've done two women in a row.
Yeah. Okay.
NewYorkDailyNews.com was the other source.
Okay. Wow, you didn't use any tabloids this time. Like my
I know.
Yours was all tabloids.
With tabloids, yes.
You used real grown-up sources.
Kind of, except, all the paparazzi of the graves.
Oh, God.
I know. Isn't that crazy?
That's so crazy?
Even back then, we always talk about how the news is so sensational, but it's always been that way. So
that's true. Oh, that was a good story.
Pretty crazy.
That was always be weary of a woman who purposely goes by the name Fanny. That's a red flag.
And I think she's my second Fanny, too. That wasn't the other poisoner as well. I know. Let's see.
I'm trying to remember. You have two Fannies.
I think I have two Fannies. I have two Fanny stories. I'm trying to remember the other one because I know there was another Fanny.
I think there was another Fanny.
And it was a historical one too.
That is a red flag.
Yep. Do not go with Fannies.
Beware of Fannies. Always.
Always be aware of Fanny.
It's just good advice. It's just good solid advice.
She should have gone by Mary. Mary would have been
God.
Better. We need to do a shout out too.
Oh, what are we shouting?
We got another Patreon subscriber. Why are we shouting? We got another Patreon subscriber.
Oh, yay! Oh, that's so awesome.
Yes. So thank you, Carrie, for
joining
our cult. Wait, what?
Cult.
The Cult of Oddies.
Fan club.
We're not a cult. We don't want to be a cult.
Thinking so Scientology. Oh, wait. I'm sorry. Did I say that?
Oh, now they're going to hunt you down. Watch out.
Shit.
What is it? The ocean something.
Tom Cruise is going to
go
after me.
Tom. No, Tom.
The Sea Org.
The Sea Org. All 5'4" of him. It's going to. I could sit on him. Done for.
I could sit on him.
I'll sit on him. Hold him down while you're slapping.
Oh, God. Okay. What were we talking about? Sorry.
Talking about Carrie and how amazing. And
yes, Carrie. Thank you.
She is now a part of the Audi cult.
Aw, thanks for being an Audi with us.
Yes.
For embracing your inner Audi.
Well, join us next week.
Yes,
for
please.
Another crazy episode.
Potentially based out of Florida.
There's always that potential.
There's always a good chance it's going to be based out of Florida.
Sorry, Florida, but it's true. You know it's true.
You bring it on yourself. Oh, shit. Okay. Thanks, everybody. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Hey, Oddies, thanks for listening to another episode of ODFM. If you're a longtime listener, hey, we cannot thank you enough for your continued support. And if you're a new listener, thanks for giving us a try. If you like us, please drop us a like, subscribe, or rate us so we can share our stories with more people around the world. And if you'd like more information, like links to our podcast and socials, along with our Patreon fan page, Those links are all on Linktree under ODFM Podcast. That's linktr.ee/ODFM Podcast. Side note, you guys, we're obsessed with fan art and we love making things with it, like stickers for our fans. So if you'd like us to use your designs, send it to us at odfmpodcast@gmail.com. And if we use your design, we'll be sure to send you a sticker.
Thanks for listening to another episode of ODFM, hosted by Kelly DeVries and Jenna Swanson. Production and editing by Kelly DeVries. Theme music by Eric Swanson. ODFM is a satirical true crime podcast for entertainment purposes only. The stories you hear are serious and true. The comments and opinions are not. We apologize if any of our content is harmful or disrespectful.
Fender returns with his brilliant new album, 17 Going Under. Includes the singles 17 Going Under, Get You Down, and Spit of You. Sam Fender, 17 Going Under, out now.